This is Merryn Jose, and you're listening to MerlianNewsPodcast.com. Today we have the pleasure of interviewing Dr. John Diamond. Dr. Diamond is a pioneering figure in alternative medicine. He began his career in psychiatry, but expanded into holistic medicine. His discovery of the link between the meridians and the emotions is one example of a remarkable body of work. He is past president of the International Academy of Preventative Medicine and is a best-selling author of over 20 books, including Your Body Doesn't Lie, Life Energy, and his recent book, The Diamond Color Meditation, which you can find reviewed on MerlianNews.com. So today we have the pleasure of interviewing Dr. John Diamond. So welcome to the show, Dr. Diamond.
Thank you, Merryn.
Now, for my first question, can you give us the definition of holism?
Holism is looking at the person who comes to you, what I call the sufferer, examining all the shaping forces that have made him or her exactly as they are now. All the positive forces and all the negative forces. Social pressures, emotional problems, genetics, everything that makes that person exactly as they are now, as they're sitting before me right now. That's holism true. Is looking at everything. You can say it's body, mind and spirit, but that to me is splitting up the whole, which is the total person. It's this understanding of all the shaping forces that have made that person uniquely that person. Everything you might say positive, and everything you might say negative that has brought him to be that person to me now to be helped.
My goodness, that's a lot to deal with, actually.
Oh, that's the fun of it. That's the real fun. Yeah. Anything less than that is just partial. It's the fun of looking at that person at this moment in time and looking all the way back to this moment and then hopefully looking with your help to the future.
Yes, you really are a pioneer. So Dr. Diamond, I believe you were one of the first to come out with clinical affirmations, is that true?
I suppose so, because I related them all to many, many problems relating to what I call the acupuncture emotional system. Shall I tell you the best affirmation of all?
Yes,
so far.
Please.
There are many. I myself, in my own meditation every day and what I teach people every day, there are many. But here's my favorite at the moment. You ready?
Yes. Please.
I enthusiastically, passionately, wholeheartedly, gratefully embrace all my life, with the accent on the all. Mm-hmm. I enthusiastically, passionately, wholeheartedly, gratefully embrace all my life.
That's a wonderful affirmation.
Thank you.
And it works, obviously, because you are very enthusiastic. Now, here also, you were one of the first to express the importance of the thymus gland.
Right.
And apparently, most people said it was useless.
Yeah. The thymus gland was thought to have been important in children, but then of no value in adults, which was just medically untrue. Which was eventually found out. To point now, in the old days, a cardiac surgeon would suck out the thymus gland when he operated on the heart, just routinely suck it out.
Really?
Then they decided not to. Now we know how much it's involved in the immune system throughout age, but I use the thymus in a slightly different way.
Oh, yes.
The Greek word, which it comes from, thymos or timos, means life energy, the power within an individual, the healing power. So I use it in the physical sense, thymus, but more so in the metaphorical sense of the life, although I think it's physical, the life energy within an individual. And then looking at all the factors that raise the life energy or lower it. And then what I found is the thymus is the controlling, shall we say, power in the body for the whole acupuncture emotional system. So when, in this sense, your thymus, your thymus is high, then you are in a healing mode, you are in a positive mode, you are enthusiastically, passionately, wholeheartedly, gratefully embracing all of your life.
I see. Thank you. So What do you actually mean, or give us another name for life energy?
Chi, prana.
Yes.
Hippocrates call it the healing power within, vis medicatrix naturi, the healing power of nature. Mm. It's what is in us. What we all have is this ability to grow and to heal, to develop, to grow and to heal. You cut yourself, it heals. Mm-hmm. That's life energy. Unfortunately, most people's life energy is low.
Yeah.
And when they come to me, one of my primary tasks is to assess just how high, or usually how low, is that life energy? What are the factors that have caused it to go down? And how do we together help to raise his life energy? But I can't give him life energy.
No.
He has it. It's all I'm doing is awakening. I sometimes think it's like the sleeping princess.
Mm-hmm.
And all you do is you just touch her, you just awaken her. But she's there inside all the time, ready to heal us.
Mm.
We just have to make contact with her.
Mm.
And the healer's job is to help the sufferer make contact with his life energy.
Yes, because some people seem to be born with so much life energy. Like you, for instance. You have an enormous life force. So how
do
you account for that?
I think we all have the same amount of life energy.
Mm.
It's that some of us, luckily, have been able to utilize it more. But everybody is highly enthused with life energy. It's there. No one is hopeless. The life energy is always there. You just have to find out the way to help them to actuate it.
Yes.
Now, can I talk about this word actuate
yes,
for a minute?
Please.
Because actuate does not mean activate.
Mm-hmm.
I can't activate someone else's life energy. I can't create it for them.
No.
But I can help them turn the switch. That's what actuate means. It's there inside. It just needs the switch to be turned. Nobody is hopeless. There's always the life energy there just waiting to be actuated.
That's very interesting. So you're very important in this work here.
He doesn't need me to do it. There's many, many ways. He can suddenly look at a tree and actuate his own life energy. He can suddenly listen to a piece of music. All sorts of things can suddenly happen. I mean, literally, a lightning bolt can happen and he has changed. It can be anything that actuates the life energy because it's always there inside. It's always there. Up until the moment we die, it's always there.
Yeah. So what are three things that the listeners can do to raise their life energy?
Well, the first of all, recognize that they have it. That's the most important thing. And then secondly, from my point of view, is to realize that we are all loved, that we have all been given an enormous amount of love by just the world around us. There are difficulties, yes, but the love and the world around us. But the third thing I can talk about, nutrition and so forth, but other people can talk about that.
Mm.
But to me, one of the most important things, which is what I try to do with everyone who comes to see me, is to help them to help raise someone else's life energy.
Oh,
if you want to raise your life energy with the best of intention, if you are altruistic to another,
mm-hmm.
That's what makes the difference.
I see.
So what I want, what I do all the time, when someone's in trouble, I want them to help someone else who's in trouble.
Yes.
Altruism is the secret. I was just doing a whole lot of work with Alcoholics Anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
And the secret of Alcoholics Anonymous, to me, is its altruism.
Yes.
It's all based, and that was the genius of it, it's all based on helping others.
Yes.
And people come to me, they want help for themselves. No, I want to help them to help others. Egoism is illness.
Mm-hmm.
Altruism is health. When they look at the other, because alter, which we get altruism, means other.
Mm-hmm.
When they help the other, when their desire is for the other, that's what raises their own life energy. As long as they're not helping the other, as a means of helping themselves, yes. as long as that's not their intention.
Yes, otherwise it's
selfish again.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, what are some things then in daily life that actually reduce the life energy?
Oh.
There's a list.
Yeah. where do you start? There's negative thoughts, negative nutrition. Mm. There's so many factors, electromagnetic forces. You look at the shaping forces, and so many of these shaping forces are positive, but many of them are negative.
Yes.
You're living next to a radiation tower, you're going to have your life energy lowered.
Mm.
You listen to all the negativity that we have today on television and so forth, it's going to lower your life energy.
Mm.
Digital sound, by and large, unless you take precautions, will lower your life energy.
Really?
There's all sorts of factors. We just have to realize that so much of our present society, both the mechanical factors in our society and the overall level of fear and tension in our society at the moment, is all lowering our life energy.
Mm.
And our duty is to recognize this and do what we can to turn it around.
Mm.
And again, the affirmation that I gave
yes,
you will help
yes,
with that.
Yes, yes.
To embrace all of our life, including the present fears that we're all living in.
Yes, indeed. We are living under a lot of fear.
Yeah.
I know in New York City, there's tremendous fear in New York City since 9/11.
Oh, yes.
I mean, around the world, of course, but it has reduced people's energies. And
yeah.
a lot of people have been taking tranquilizers, drinking more.
Yeah.
That's been going on.
Well, you see, as I say, my first assessment when someone comes to see me is to determine what is the level of their life energy, which you can interpret as how much do they really, really want to be healthy. And it's very, very, very few. And since 9/11, it has become less.
Yes.
And when I talk to other doctors of a similar vein of thought to me, they agree it's getting more and more difficult because the overall level of the desire for health in the population has gone down. And I say, this is not only here, this is what I find in England and Australia, parts of Europe, I know not as much. It's a problem, and that's what we have to individually work on correcting. Our society's, what I call, inner flame has come down.
Yes.
And it's our job as individuals to raise our own inner flame.
Mm.
Inner flame is what I mean by life energy.
Yes.
You know, and we want our inner flames to be bursting out of us, full of energy. We want to be afire. We want to be passionate, embracing all of life.
Mm.
And that gets increasingly difficult when all the reports that we read go the other way. If I may mention one little anecdote. Many, many years ago, I met Mrs. Carlson, the widow of the inventor of Xerox.
Oh, yes.
And she had a huge estate up in Buffalo. Very, very tranquil old lady. The Lama Govinda used to go there, a lot of Buddhist monks and so forth. And I said, what's the secret of your peace and happiness?
Hmm.
She said, the first thing is, don't read the newspapers.
Ah, absolutely.
We need to feel as free of fear as we can be.
Mm-hmm.
And that's having what I call faith and confidence in our future.
Yes. It's so interesting you said not to read the newspapers.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people end their day watching the news. Mm.
You can watch it if you are very circumspect, if you hold on to the positive. I mean, if you've got a wound, like it's bleeding, it's fine to look at the wound. Don't turn away from it. But don't get, as it were, sucked into it. Just observe. This is part of the shaping forces that is going on at the moment.
Mm.
Part of the shaping forces.
Yes. In your new book, The Diamond Color Meditation, you mentioned that color is a vibrational healing modality. How do you define vibrational modality?
Well, I like to think of, I love William Blake, the poet, the painter. And a word he loved was emanation, which is a word I love. It's what comes from everybody, every flower, every person, every painting, every piece of music has this emanation of life energy coming from it.
Yeah.
And it's very specific. So this Beethoven symphony will have a different emanation than this Bach or this person from that person. And every color has this spiritual vibration that it's putting out, each very, very, very specific, and each its own emanation, each its own manifestation of what you might call the universal spirit.
Yes. So all colours have vibrational healing qualities.
Oh, yes.
Then.
Oh, yes. The colours in the book have been chosen as a result of about 25 or more years of research in colour. Yeah. They're very, very specific, and they were very, very difficult to get accurately printed. Very difficult. Some of them are taken from Professor Max Lucia.
Oh, yes.
Who developed who's a dear friend of mine, who developed the Lucia test many, many years ago. Some I've developed, some are from him, and they're very, very specific. So just taking this green or this blue won't work. It's got to be exactly that particular one. And then using it in the way that we talk about as a very brief, what do we call daily meditation. Mm.
Recently, you've written a book called Facets of a Diamond.
Yes.
Which you say comprehensively encompasses your philosophy of life and holism. Can you share a story from that for our listeners?
Yes. Many years ago, when I was working in a psychiatric hospital in charge of inducting all the patients and farming them out to the young doctors, I would see every new patient, and they'd also be seen by a psychologist. Mm-hmm. At lunchtime, we would meet. And he would say, you know, you're brilliant. You pick up every hallucination, every delusion. But did you know this one was a champion camellia grower? This one was a wonderful piano player? I said, no. I said, I'm a doctor. I'm not trained to find the good things.
Mm.
And then years later, I realized what really matters is not the bad things. Mm. We know this person is schizophrenic. We know he can't do that. We know that. But what can he do?
Yes.
That's what matters. Mm. I saw a man just recently, a young boy, who was very, very crippled with, they told me, Lyme disease. Mm. Very, very crippled. And he's lying there in this bed, you know, in a sense, more dead than alive. He was 14. And I said to him, and he wasn't my patient. The doctors are doing this, doing that. Good work, good work.
Mm.
And I said, what really matters to you? What turns you on?
Mm.
And he suddenly sits up in the bed. He said, my guitars. I love my guitars. Mm. And he starts to imagine he's playing one.
Oh.
So tell me about your guitars. Mm. Bring a guitar next time.
Mm.
I want to know the positive.
Yes.
We dwell on the negative, the negative, the negative.
That's
we
true.
Put down diagnosis schizophrenia. We don't put down positive diagnosis guitar player.
Yes, of course.
It's all the negative.
Yes.
And it's what I call the two wheels on dry land, not the two wheels in the mud, which gets the car out. It's the it's the good things that we do. It's the creative things. That's what makes the difference. We need to reverse all of our diagnoses. When someone comes to me, no matter what's wrong, I want to know what's right. They've been given this problem, but they've also been given this gift, this positive sort of thing. Yes, he's dyslexic, terribly dyslexic, but what a wonderful artist he is. There's always the other side. I've seen some incredibly autistic children and adults who are wonderful pianists, crippled here, genius there. So I say, if God tapped you on the shoulder today and he said, this is your moment, how can you convince him to come back tomorrow? I haven't finished the symphony. I haven't finished the poem. I haven't danced enough. Whatever it may be, the positive, the positive. That is one of the things I talk about in the Facets book.
Oh, Dr. Diamond, thank you so much for being with us today. I feel totally enthused and positive.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So our listeners can read more about Dr. John Diamond on his website at www.drjohndiamond.com. You can read book reviews on Facets of a Diamond and the Diamond Colour Meditation at www.merlianews.com. This is Merryn Jose, and thank you for listening to Merlian.